Today I speak to Maureen Shea, a professional female boxer born in the Bronx. She is of Irish and Mexican descent. She is a two-time professional world champion, and she first came to our attention as the main sparring partner to Oscar-winning actress Hilary Swank in the 2004 classic Million Dollar Baby. Shay, welcome. How are you today?
Thank you. I'm wonderful. Thank you so much. It's so funny when I think back, just even that it's still surreal to me that's my life. I'll be honest. It's still surreal. And I'm like, wow, I remember that. I remember that.
I know you come from a unique heritage. Mm-hmm. Irish, Mexican, grew up in the Bronx. A great boxer loves a good combination. It doesn't get any better than this. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about your family, your parents growing up in the Bronx.
It was very interesting because everybody always asks me, Mexican, Irish, how did that happen? I'm like, well, my mother was born in Queens. My grandparents immigrated here from Mexico. My grandfather was from Guadalajara, Jalisco, and my grandmother was from Nayarit, Tepic. And my grandfather actually came over. I can't really go back to the years, but he joined the Navy. And then he came over, and then he brought my grandmother over to get his citizenship. He joined the Navy. So he was in the military. And then they had my mom and my aunt, who are identical twins. I have pictures of my grandfather and my grandmother, and my grandfather they're both holding my mom and my aunt. And my grandmother was 4'11". And my grandfather was like 5'2". So there's three women. There's three of them. There's the twins, and then there's Debbie, 15 years apart. And then my father's side, my father is the middle of three boys, my uncle Richard, my father, and then my uncle Danny. And funny story about my grandfather, who again, I never met my grandfathers. You know, they passed away very young.
And they're from Ireland, yes? So what part of Ireland?
So it's so funny. So my grandparents were not born in Ireland. My great grandparents were. So we tried tracing it back. Actually, during Million Dollar Baby, I had a lot of interest in Ireland about my background. Mm-hmm. So we always thought we were from County Kerry, but we don't really know because where the records were held, they caught fire. So we'd have to actually do the DNA. But my father hasn't done it. My father's kind of sketchy on that stuff. He's very old school. He's like, I'm not giving anybody my DNA. But I recently did it.
That's the NYPD man.
Oh, yeah, too.
Isn't that what he was? He was he's a retired NYPD officer.
He did 21 years. He was a detective in the NYPD and a Marine. So I did actually do the 23andMe, and I went back and I see, you know, there's a cluster. So I'd have to really probably use his DNA to go back and see, or my brother's, if I can convince him. County Kerry, County Cork, even Cork, were very, you know, Shay. So my grandmother always said, and we don't know this to be factual, but she always said we dropped the O in the ocean. We're not O'Shea. Because everybody would always call us O'Shea.
O'Shea, yeah.
So there's a lot, you know, and I know that they came through Ellis Island, you know. So my great-grandparents were from Ireland.
Okay, so Maureen, I have to ask you, when did you first lace up a pair of gloves? Where did this initial interest come from?
I was 17 years old.
Oh, really?
So the first time that I ever saw boxing, I was like 15. And it was when I was at a friend's house in upstate New York, and his father had some people over, and we were all hanging out in the kitchen. I literally go back to this moment in my brain because I remember it so clearly. We're all sitting around. I got to set it up. So we're sitting around the kitchen. The dining room table, and all of a sudden, so it was the dining room, the kitchen, and then there was like a drop, and then there was the living room. So all of a sudden, his father had people over, and they're all start going, oh, like people getting crazy, and we're like, what the heck's going on? There was like five of us. We all ran into the kitchen, and it was when Mike Tyson bit Evander Holyfield's ear. So when I saw that, I'm like, why would he do that? And I started hearing them talking about it, and then them sharing some of his history and, you know, Mike Tyson's background, and I was just so intrigued that that was it. Then fast forward a couple of years later, I ended up in an abusive relationship with an individual who was, I mean, I met him when I was 16. We started dating when I was 17, and he was like my best friend. You know, we did everything together, and I mean, everything was family stuff. Like, he would come vacationing with my family, and his family knew me, and we were all very close. But then he kind of changed. And I speak, this is why I do the work I do with domestic violence. You know, people don't understand how it starts. And I didn't understand until now that back then it started as, you know, we fall in love, you know, whatever young love is, and then more codependency and the need to be with somebody because you're still trying to find your way. And then he started to kind of call me names, but it was like playful, but slowly chipping away at you start questioning yourself. And I think some women don't end up in that because it's different because they didn't feel maybe like I felt like misunderstood. So I kind of let him mold me a little bit because I didn't get it. And I was looking for somebody. So between that codependency and that, I'm like, oh, maybe I started questioning myself because I didn't have a firm grip on who I was.
Yeah.
So I started letting that mold me. So and I was trying to figure myself out. So with that, I ended up, and then it became physical, where he had his issues from his childhood, and later to find out that he was taking steroids. And we know that chemical substances of whatever they are, whether they're steroids, any kind of drugs taken in high amounts can change somebody's personality. And he became physically abusive, having roid rages and flipping out on me, you know, like getting to that from here. It was never this, it was this to this. And it was always my fault. And it was always my fault. And I felt very much like it was my fault. I believed it because I was so confused. And I was so, it's like, you know, you can either say, okay, I misunderstood. I'm either good or bad. And for whatever reason, I felt like I was bad. Like I deserved it.
So did you start boxing during all of this? And then you started to find out about yourself?
I went to the gym. Well, I went to the gym to better myself for him, believe it or not. So I went to the gym completely because I thought I wasn't good enough. And I thought I was fat and ugly. And I went there and I walked to the back and there was a boxing gym. I fell in love after that.
Really?
But you know, it was funny because it wasn't like I could, you know, I would go there every day because I was looking for something and I didn't even realize it. I was looking for something in here and boxing helped me kind of find it. And it wasn't like, everybody always asked me, oh, so you went there to beat him up, to fight him? I'm like, first of all, you watch too many movies because everybody compares it to Jennifer Lopez and enough. I'm like, no, actually I went there to better me. I was afraid of him. And I found through that, I built my self-esteem and I started feeling boxing. I always say this in my quotes, boxing was the architect that rebuilt me because I was so broken. And through boxing, it's so unforgiving. And I also say that it taught me things my parents couldn't teach me. And because it's so like this or that, like you can't lie, you can't hide. And you really find out about yourself when the first time I sparred, I quit. Because everybody gets tested in boxing. You can have every boxer on here from Muhammad Ali, God rest his soul, all the way down to a newbie who's actually fighting amateur right now. And they'll tell you that they've all been tested, you know, because everybody does. That's how you can tell if you're a fighter or not. I won my first world title and I didn't think I deserved it because in my head, people don't even know that the depression that I struggled with and just all of that. It takes time to rebuild when you have it from like a very young age. You know, you have this. It's crazy. I was just speaking to my trainer about the person that I am today. I'm like, I have a confidence and people sense the confidence because it's true, but it's real. But I had to like work to get to this place. I wasn't just born like this.
She is the IFBA female super bantamweight champion of the world, Maureen, the real $1 million baby, Shea.
2004. Because, you know, I'm a film buff as well, so I need to ask you more about this, okay?
Of course.
So 2004 was a big moment in your life. So you were training with Hector Roca, world-renowned boxing trainer. He's trained something like 13 world champions. And is this true? He was approached by Hilary Swank looking to train for the movie Million Dollar Baby. And was it he that recommended you to spar with her? Or how did you get thrown into the mix? Yeah.
Okay, so I'll take even back to that. It wasn't approached by Hilary. It was somebody else approached him about, or he's worked with other actors in the past. So they obviously recommended him for Hilary. And I remember the I don't know if it was the first or second day Hilary came in. I didn't meet her right away. She was in the office speaking to Bruce Silverglade. And I went in to buy something from Bruce, hand wraps or something. And she was there. And you know, the thing about Gleason's and anybody who's watching this that's ever been there or knows somebody there, we don't get starstruck because we're fighters and we're pretty ruthless. And when you first go to Gleason's, you have to prove yourself. Like when I first went to Gleason's, they put me in there with a pro to spar. And if I failed, I was out. Anyway, I go into the office and Hillary's in there And Bruce introduced us, and Bruce had said, oh, you'll probably be working with Maureen. But we had, like I said, actors were coming in, like, revolving, you know, John Leguizamo was there, Usher was there, 50 Cent was there, and we were just like, whatever. So then she came in and we started working together. And I think the reason, from what I understand, I'm sure Hector would say this too, the reason that he parted me with her was because I knew how to work.
Maureen Shea, 24 years old, representing Gleason's Gym, a student from the Bronx. She was a sparring partner for actress Hilary Swank.
Moments ago, during the intermission, between rounds, Hilary Swank got up from her seat and walked into the corner to urge on Maureen Shea. There's Hilary reaching up to Maureen, getting her attention and urging her on. And Shea comes out strong. Change of jams, that's it. The Oscar Award winner who worked with Maureen Shea a year ago is here.
I had a job to do, and it wasn't to beat her up. It was to do this punch, this combination when she would do this, this, and this. So I did that. And I also, you know, I got to know her and I was like, you know, okay, she's not my competitor. I knew the difference between competition and work. So we worked and we worked 3 times a week and we sparred 3 times a week for 6 months. And I welcomed her into my life as much as she welcomed me into hers. So she was welcomed by everybody, really.
Yeah, she's a wonderful actress. And is it true that she based her fight style on you in the movie?
I think that happened organically because she was a Southpaw. Yeah. She trained orthodox, but she's actually fought Southpaw in the movie.
Oh, okay.
And but there's one story that I want to share that was really cool. Her dad, I believe he was in the Air Force, and my dad was in the Marines. And it was so ironic. My dad never came to the gym with me. And one day, I can count literally maybe on like 3 fingers how many times my dad came to the gym. I don't even remember. I remember one time, though. And it was the time that Hilary brought her father. And my father and her father got to watch us spar.
Fun fact, I don't know if I talked to you about this before. Going back to the movie for a moment. Makushla, the nickname, Makushla.
Yes.
That Clint Eastwood's character.
My darling, my love.
Yeah. Gives Maggie. And in the end, he reveals what the nickname means. Because all through the movie, she was like, what does this mean? But there are 2 mistakes in this movie.
So, I love this stuff, though. I love when people figure that out. I'll go on to IMBD and I'll try to look up like what. Yeah.
Okay. So Makushla, first of all, he says it means my darling, my blood.
My blood. That's right.
Okay. Now that's pretty close. It's pretty close. But the actual translation is my pulse. My pulse. So basically, he means you're what keeps me going. You keep me alive.
Wow.
So basically the same meaning, but my pulse is what it means.
Kushla means my darling, my blood.
Also, and it was a beautiful moment when he presents her with the robe and they're walking down to the ring, Makushla and the Irish harp logo on the back, but it's spelt wrong. Oh, Makushla is spelt wrong.
I think they gave you somebody else's.
You know what's funny? When I fought in the garden, it was short after the film, 2006, when I fought on John Duddy's. We were the Shamrock Express. It was myself, John Duddy, and James Moore. And we fought, and I remember I came out to bagpipes. It was like I did what I wanted. I wanted to do my hair, not because of Hilary. I did my hair like this, and then the girl, the Haitian girl that did my hair was like, well, why don't we put some, what color is your outfit? I'll put some ribbon in it. And I said, oh, well, it's gold and green. And she said, all right, I'll put gold ribbon. And I did it. And it was funny because that was when Mickey Ward commentated with Barry McGuigan. There was a time where they were talking about my hair. It was funny because they didn't know women's boxing enough. And I remember, and Mickey was one of my all-time favorite fighters. I was at Gotti Ward One. I was there ringside in Ward's corner for Gotti Ward One. Mind you, not that I was like a big fan of, I mean, I was a big fan of both of them, but I knew that Hector worked with Arturo and I had met Arturo. So for me, it was like, oh, Arturo, but Mickey's Irish. And I liked Mickey. And it's so funny because
my favorite fight of all time, that one.
I was at one and I was at three. So just to tell you, that was my first time seeing like a big professional fight. I was 21 years old. And I remember picking up the tickets and Luigi's looking at them. He's like, I don't know if this is correct, but we sit in front row. Like I always watch the fight. And I try to find myself in Ward's corner because I literally was like three seats in from Ward's corner. And I mean,
I'm gonna look at it again.
It was insane. You know, but I met Mickey later on. We did a lot of work together. So here's a funny story. Well, it's a pretty heartwarming story. People who know Mickey Ward, or you'll appreciate this. So I was part of this exhibit called The Fighting Irishman. I was the only female featured in the exhibit. And it was they had Gene Tunney's arm. I think it was Gene Tunney's arm in there or something like that. Somebody's arm. It was very interesting. And so they had like all these Irish fighters and all that, like memorabilia. And they had me, my skirt and my glove that Hillary, because in the finals of the Golden Gloves, Hillary touched my glove. It was like a Hollywood moment. So they wanted the glove. They wanted my outfit. So anyway, we had to do this round table. And then afterwards, we did autograph signings and they printed up a bunch of photos and Mickey was there. Mickey was obviously part of it. And I remember I got a tap on my shoulder. I was talking to somebody. I'll never forget. I turned around. Mickey Ward's holding my photo, asking me for an autograph.
Mickey Ward asked you for an autograph. Wow. What a
moment
that is.
And I looked at him and I was just like, and then he really respected me and women's boxing. And, you know, I did an event with him for Everlast because he was with Everlast and I was with Everlast. And we did it at Crunch Fitness and he showed up and they were taking pictures in the ring. And he was like, hey, they're doing a movie about me. I said, get out of here. Who? He goes, Mark Wahlberg. I said, get out of here. What's, you know, he's like, yeah. He's like, I'm really excited about it. The Fighter.
After the movie, The Fighter, I did a fun little impression of Mickey Ward online. It was on YouTube. And next thing I get an email to my website from his... Nick Cardasco, his agent. And he said, I just thought you'd like to know. I just sat down and watched your impression with Mickey and we love it. You know, so it was a really nice email to receive. You know, I was just Googling images and there was two images beside each other. And one of them, it almost pained me to even look at it, where you're lying on the canvas, you know, and I'm like looking at this. And then the next picture, you're standing up, fierce but feminine, with your four or five titles all around you. And I'm like, the strength that takes, the character that takes to go from this to this, that's special. So, you know, that's what I'm saying. A lot of boxers, they've had an amazing journey because they're made of something that normal people are not made of.
And like that photo that you're talking about, that's one of my favorite photos because that was my first loss. And people don't know what happened in that fight. It wasn't because, and all due respect to my opponent, it wasn't because she was better than me. It was because I blew my eardrum in the fifth round and I dropped her in the first round. And that was for the WBA. It was 130-pound world title, which now I fight at like 118 and 122. So, you know, so I was still maturing and it was my 13th, 14th fight in the Garden where my Bob Arum wanted to sign me after this fight, where I had a meeting with him, me and my manager. And I actually sold myself to Bob Arum. I had a whole, and I told him why. Because he was so against women's boxing. And I looked at him because I knew I had a job. I knew I had to get on this card. And I was going to do whatever I had to do, like, you know, to degree to get on. I had to be confident. Because he didn't want a weak woman. He wanted somebody who's going to be like, well, I'm not going to take no for an answer. So I went and he said all this. And I said, listen, with all due respect to Lucia Riker and Christy Martin, I'm not Lucia Riker or Christy Martin. I'm Maureen Shea. And I'm going to bring you this, this, and this. I said, I speak fluent Spanish. I can sell to the Spanish media. And my manager helped me with my confidence. He said, Maureen, do you realize the gifts that you have?
Yeah, because you're talking about fighting on a card. And you remind me of when you were the co-main event with Shane Mosley. Was that 2010?
That was 15.
You're right.
So I fought. So I had the IFBA. That's where I defended the IFBA and I fought for the IBF. She had the IBF. I had the IFBA. And that ended in a draw. But the fight, and yeah. And there was, I mean, it just.
And that, the amazing thing about that, sorry, but just because it fascinated me.
Yeah.
So you defended your IFBA title on your co-main event with Shane Mosley.
And that was at 122. That's when I dropped.
122, okay. Yeah. But that was the first time in over 10 years that a ladies' fight was on a pay-per-view event. Like, so that, and it's not long ago, which is kind of scary, but it speaks volumes of your talent as a boxer and as an entertainer that you did this. And if you ask me, this has made a huge difference in paving the way for female boxers. Which brings me to my next question, my fellow compatriot, Katie Taylor. What are your thoughts on Katie Taylor?
I think Katie Taylor is wonderful. I think I love how she conducts herself. I actually had spoken to her coach because I know she was training in Connecticut. And, you know, I think I liked her in the amateurs. I actually, when Queen Underwood fought her in the nationals, or maybe it was the trials, I sparred with Queen Underwood. And you know, and I knew, and I love how, and I knew about Katie Taylor back when I was fighting on John Duddy's card, back when I was working with Irish Ropes Promotions. Eddie McLaughlin would always tell me about Katie Taylor, but she was big on soccer. And he would always say, like, I don't think her father's going to turn her pro because she's got soccer and there's so much more in soccer for
her.
She
was an Irish international soccer player.
Yeah. So she was always
very all-around athlete.
Yeah, an athlete. And I know, and I said, well, it makes sense because the women's, again, a fact people don't know is that women's boxing wasn't recognized in the Olympics or introduced into the Olympics until 2013.
Because of Katie Taylor. She brought that in 2012 in London. She fought for that. She often says this was one of her biggest fights, fighting to get women's boxing in the Olympics.
Of course.
So she is. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and it was all the way back. But the thing is that going back to that, this was when I heard about her, it was like 2006 and I heard about her. And then it was like, you know, she's pushed, but it's women that, imagine if women like myself just quit. Even if we didn't go pro, we just quit. All of us just quit because there was no Olympics. Somebody made a comment the other day and I had to kind of like, I don't really chime in on Facebook stuff too much unless it's something I really feel like it needs to be said. And he was like, oh, every fighter's dream, you know, male or female, is to fight in the Olympics. And you're not every American boxer's dream or something like that. I said, okay, well, not all of us had that opportunity.
Yeah.
So, you know, to me, it wasn't my dream. I never thought about it because it wasn't an opportunity. It wasn't even an option. Again, go back to Katie Taylor, huge amount of respect for her. But there's women that are more polished. That's why Katie Taylor had a hard time with Delphine Persoon, because she's a polished pro. And that's what gave her a hard time. And I guarantee you, Katie will have, it's going to be an interesting fight with Amanda Serrano, because Amanda Serrano, polished professional. Katie Taylor has a ton of experience, of athleticism, of gifts, but she doesn't have the experience that Amanda has. And Amanda's seen stuff, and Amanda knows how to get out of stuff. And I've been there because I fought younger girls, and they are a lot younger than me, but my experience carries me through. You know, I never had... Even this photo, which was done by you, which I love.
Shout out.
I love it. This photo, I never had boxing stuff in my house.
Oh, wow.
And my belts, I have two of my belts. The other two I brought over to my WBC and my NABF are right now at Phil, my strength and conditioning coach's gym, because he does a podcast and he wanted, we're going to get copies of the belts so that he could have them and I can have mine back. But I have my NABA and my IFBA here. And I just never had boxing stuff in my house. Like, this photo represents such a moment. And I don't even know if you realize, like.
Well, I instantly loved the image. So credit to the photographer. I loved it straight away. Such a powerful image. Can't really see it from here, but the look in your eyes. So talk us through it, this moment.
Well, so it was, you know, that was a very interesting fight. So that was my first time fighting for a world title. No, my second time fighting for a world title at 122. And, you know, with the IBF. And it was, I did have footage on her because she's from Mexico and there really was no footage. The footage I had of her was her fighting another girl. I think she defended the title or she won the title against an Argentinian girl. Issue is, again, what people don't know, what's her height? What's her reach? They didn't have it on BoxRec. So I tried looking at the video going, is this girl short? Is she tall? Like, what's the difference? I didn't know what the other girl was either because I tried to research that. We couldn't find anything. So all I had was this video. And in this video, she was coming forward on this girl. So I'm like, okay, she's Mexican. I don't know how tall she is. So she could be shorter. She's strong. She's coming forward. She's using her range, but she's still walking this girl down. So sure enough, I'm thinking, all right. So I trained for this fight for like come out the first round. This girl won't touch me. She's like, and I'm like, oh man, now in my head, literally the first round, it's like, this is pay-per-view, women's boxing. You got to make this a fight. 50 Cent is in the crowd. Shane Mosley is the main event. You're opening up the show. It's on TV. So I fought out of my fight, what the plan was. And I started coming forward. And I started, you know, I felt I won the fight based on the power shots and the effective aggression. And I felt like I controlled it. She was boxing. She did very well, but I felt that I should have won the fight. It was very close. So I'm not mad at a draw, but I felt that I edged it out. And but they did give it a draw. And then, you know, but that was the thing. So I'm coming out. I'm like, I had to find a way to land that freaking right hand on a girl who had 7-inch reach on me or 3.5-inch reach on me. And that's what I love about that photo. Because no matter what, like she, I landed that right hand. I found a way for that right hand, even though she just tapped me, I turned her head. This fight, her style, very similar to Kina Malpartida, who I had the loss to in the garden, that fight we're talking about, where I blew my eardrum.
Yeah.
With Kina, I remember when Kina would grab me, that's where she cupped my ears and I blew my eardrum. That was the round.
I mean, your balance must have been all over the place.
Let me tell you, so I never blew my eardrum. Ever. I didn't know what it felt like. So I remember, this is where my memory comes in. I remember when the ref separated us, I heard in my head. Then I was like, okay, I'm good. And I was coming out. I heard whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. The whole time I could hear everything in my head. And I was so confused. It wasn't a punch that she hit me that was so hard. Because honestly, she didn't hit hard. This girl didn't hit hard either. My face, people look at my face like your face. I'm like, I'm white. I mark. I'm like George St. Pierre. My face marks all the time if I get even touched. Even sparring, my headgear marks my head. Just from the stitching. So she hit me with a right hand in that fight, the Kina fight in the garden. And it wasn't a hard right hand. I couldn't stand up anymore. 30 seconds in the 10th round, I fell over. And you want to know, if you look at my face when I'm on the canvas, I'm like confused. And I remember the ref looked at me and he said, okay, walk forward. I walked forward, but the confusion in my, because I walked forward fine. The confusion in my eyes, he stopped the fight 30 seconds in the 10th round. And I was just like, and I remember looking at her winning, jumping up, her trainer coming up, then putting the belt on her. And I was like, that's my belt. And they immediately took me to the hospital. My depth perception was completely gone.
I have to ask you, I mean, like, obviously there's the disappointment. Your body wanted to continue. You're like, that's my belt. You felt it was unfair. But from a health standpoint, do you agree it was the right decision? Can you accept that to stop the fight?
30 seconds left. I mean, as a fight, really? I mean, but yeah. I mean, I forgot who the referee was.
I mean, a lot of damage can be done in 30 seconds.
Yeah, that's true. But you know, I know. But yeah, no, I think it was the it was definitely for myself. You know what I mean? It was the right thing to do. And I'm actually, you know, I mean, it was a great fight though.
It's difficult now. You're talking about fighters and how they cope with it. But something that I always wonder myself: there are far too many tragic stories after a boxer's retire, and it just makes me wonder. Like, okay, Ricky Hatton, for example, I've spoken to Ricky Hatton. He was telling me about, you know, you crave the odd elation, the crowds. It's a very lonely place when you retire because everyone wants to be around the champion. But when it's all gone, it's a very lonely place. Is there enough done? Is there a support group? Is there enough done for boxers when they finally hang up the gloves?
It's so hard because, you know, I think that there's ring eights and ring to help the boxers, you know, there's just Alex Ramos has done a lot too with trying to support, you know, the Retired Boxers Foundation. And, you know, it's so hard because it's almost like right now, like, all right, here's an example. So right now, is there enough being done for the unemployment and the people that are struggling right now? There's only so much you can do. There's only so much money the small business loans, they ran out of money and then they're getting mad, but it's like, dude, everybody, like, it's like, I get it, but it's everybody. So it's the same thing with boxing. So I feel what's in my control as a fighter, you know, but I also, a lot of people criticize and you know, Victor Ortiz, I respect Victor.
He's a good friend of yours, isn't he? I mean, you train together at knuckleheads.
I did for a long time and I've been a big supporter. There's things in Victor's career that, but again, I don't know. I believe there's a lot of stuff that went on and a lot of stuff that he has to work through emotionally. Yeah. 100%, but that's not for me to tell him, but he's acting. He started Cologne Line. He started all these other, and people were laughing about it. A commercial he did with an aftershave. I mean, the commercial, I mean, is a little bit, but I'm like, he's out there doing things that are not boxing. Yeah. You can't be mad at these people, but I don't know. I really don't have a set thing, but I know right now I'm kind of like playing with different things where my motivational speaking, I love doing.
Exactly. And I mean, look, I talked about earlier, your passion and your infectious energy. So that's, I mean, straight away, the motivational speaking. And I know it's important to you to give back and help from your experiences. But with the energy and passion that you have and the motivation that you have, the skills you have, you have to do this. That's another calling. You have trained with, you've shared a gym with some incredible talented down the years. Give me an example. Who's the most naturally gifted? Who's the hardest worker in the gym? Give me some names.
gosh. I mean, I have to say, well, Francisco Santana, obviously, Chia to me was one of the hardest workers in the gym. You know, I have to think back because it's been so, I've trained with so many.
And we'll wrap it up after this.
I was the hardest worker in the gym. No, you know what?
Yeah, I was going to say, apart from you.
I'm not saying that because, but I always, that was my mentality because the guys,
they're
stronger, younger, but they're not going to outwork me. So it was always that.
Exactly.
You know, I have to say, I trained with Alex the Nail. Alex was a very hard worker. I've seen him work. Lomachenko, I mean, but he was so natural. He made it look effortless. We would run Arroyo Verde in Ventura. And we would all show up every Saturday and we'd be there for our runs. And Cecilio Flores, who was my strength coach at the time, would say, okay, this is strength and conditioning. He's like, okay, this is what you're going to run, what you're going to run. And I remember I run many times with Alex and with Loma and Kovalev actually came up and he strength trained with us too. And I remember Loma was in front and then I was like behind him. And then all of a sudden he laps me. And then I'm running up this hill and in my head, I'm like, man, I am like beat. You know what I mean? Like I'm running and I'm like, and all of a sudden he passes me and he gets to the top of the hill. And I'm like, you're running with your pound for pound favorite fighter. Like, come on. So I started booking it. I get to the top. He's gone. I was like, wow. How? And I look, and then I run down, then I look and I see him. I'm like, he must've been doing like a 3-minute mile. I was like, holy, I mean, just naturally gifted, but disciplined, diligent. And he had fun when he trained.
He's incredible. And there's a very good friend of mine from Poland who told me about Lomachenko before I ever heard of him. And he said, no, trust me. He says, you have to see this guy. He says, I have never seen anything like him. His footwork, his speed. He said, you just have to watch his next fight. So that's how I first learned about him. Okay, Mo, I could listen to you all day, honestly. I really could. I want to thank you so much for your sharing your time so generously and just your passion, your energy, and your stories. Just such a pleasure. And I hope I talk to you again soon.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you so
much. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did.
You're in my house. So
yes.
Who did that picture? And I'm like, right away, you know, I throw it right back to you.
Fantastic. Okay, Mo, thank you so much. Have a good day and I'll talk to you soon, okay?
God bless.
Take care. Bye-bye. Thank you.